Hey y'all, it's Miguel, here with what might be a hot take. Engineering students who can afford to buy just one laptop should not buy an M1 MacBook for fall 2021. Let me explain. By now, we've all heard of the engineering marvel that is M1. Even in mildly heavy workloads, it's very efficient. The problem is app compatibility. I knew this would be an issue when I purchased this laptop, and fortunately, I had my older Dell XPS 13 to save me. So let's cover this in two parts. First, why students need to use some apps, and second, we'll cover possible solutions to this compatibility problem. All of this is covered from a series of steps that I took to try to use my M1 for electrical and computer engineering. My first thought was alternative apps. Surely I can make do with apps designed for Mac instead of the Windows ones my professors had us use. Well, yes and no. Some apps have a clear counterpart. Take Kyle and Code Composer Studio. Both are meant for ARM and Cortex-M development. Kyle is Windows, and Code Composer is available on Mac. It's a clear counterpart. But what about Vivaldo? Vivaldo is a digital logic design software. It took like 60 gigabytes to download from the internet, and it's only available on Windows. I'm not aware of a clear Mac alternative, and I certainly didn't hear of any from my classmates. So let's say we theoretically find the Mac alternatives for our apps. The next roadblock you might encounter is professor and TA support. Our professors have designed their classes with a certain software in mind. In the case of my embedded systems class, which used Kyle, I would have liked to try and use Code Composer Studio, but my professor wrote several modules of code to assist us in Kyle, and translating between the two when I didn't have to seemed unnecessary. As for TAs, they are students who recently took the class they are now TAing for, but they likely took the class using the recommended software, and your classmates will be asking a lot of questions about the recommended software. There's an extra step between you and the solution to your problem. Now we get to working on a team. Maybe you figure out all of your issues without your professors or TAs, but there's no getting around working in groups. If you run an alternative app, but everyone else is using the recommended app, what app do you think your group is going to use? Again, it's an unnecessary conflict that makes what can already be a stressful experience that much more exasperating. Finally, in my experience, the most important part of being in class is making sure you understand the concepts, not the software. Don't get me wrong, both are important, and they sometimes go hand in hand. But engineering classes are difficult enough before you add compatibility to the mix. I recommend trying to avoid finding yourself in a stressful situation in the middle of a long semester. Ask me how I know. Alright, so maybe I've convinced you of the need to use some apps, or maybe I didn't even need to make that argument. Either way, we need some apps, not their alternatives. So what can we do? The first thing that came to my mind was Rosetta. Apple marketed this as a translation infrastructure that would make transitioning to M1 a breeze. To Apple's credit, they made a heck of a monumental leap in architecture, as seamless as I ever could have expected, given how frequently my code crashes or gets stuck in a loop. Despite this, there are apps which developers still haven't had the time to get a working solution for. Microsoft was relatively fast to bring universal support for VS Code, but it came a little too late for me to transition to it at the end of the spring semester. C-Line wasn't working well when I first got my laptop halfway through last fall. The experience with both is much smoother now, but there are still apps which haven't gotten an update. My last hope was Windows virtualization. As of making this video, Parallels has come closest to getting a great compatibility experience by enabling you to run Windows on ARM, but it's not quite as refined a process just yet, and Windows on ARM still hasn't been officially released. I'm not even sure it'll run all the apps that I mentioned I might need. Alright, so where do we stand? At the end of the spring semester, I wanted to make this video because of the struggles I had using M1. They were weighing heavily on me, literally because I was lugging around my XPS. But I didn't get around to it until now, and it was triggered by more of the same. On campus, we have these CNC machines to help us rapidly prototype. I created this PCB on them just this week. Well, wouldn't you know it, the developers haven't gotten around to building an M1 compatible piece of software. I got as far as opening the app, then adding my file, and immediately crashing. Not only that, Cura, a 3D printer slicer software that we use in the same space, still does not have official support for M1 Max. It says it right on their site. Now, I have to admit, it is very enticing when you see how fast and light and efficient these computers are. The hardware is fantastic, stellar, remarkable. As an engineering student, I deeply appreciate the engineering that went into this. But the developers around the world, whose software other engineering students and I rely on, haven't all had the resources to put together a stable and functional build yet. I'm hopeful there will be a solution, because I already own the thing, but I can't really recommend the experience. For these reasons, I think engineering students should hold off on this purchase until there is a great solution. Alright, now that the heresy is over, I want to mention that I also have experience using this machine as a liberal arts student. let me know if that's something y'all would be interested in seeing, and I'll try to crank that out. Let me know what your thoughts are, and that's all from me. I'll see you guys next time.